Hello and welcome to a free tutorial on photometric stereo imaging techniques. Recently, we released a software called Details Capture, which is designed for creating textures with photometric stereo techniques. So we have a series of photos taken with a cell phone. Details Capture can analyze these photos and produce amazing images. But if we want to shoot some high-quality photos like professional, you'd better have a scanning setup. In this tutorial, I'll talk about some issues requiring attention when we perform photometric stereo imaging. First, you need a fixed lighting setup and stationary cameras. To make a great image, we need to take short images from stationary cameras looking at the scene with light coming in turn from 8 different directions. Please make sure the cameras are well fixed and don't shake at all. Otherwise, there will be unwanted blur in the final image. And you'd better use a remote control, because pressing the shutter can cause camera movement. Also remember to turn off image stabilization, because it will result in a failure of having the photos overlap. Another thing to be noted is making sure the object is motionless during the whole process. Let's take this image of the leaf for example. As I zoom it in, you can see the leaf margin is a bit blurry. The blurry edge results from a vibration of the leaf during shooting. And here you can see this vein of the leaf is blurred. So, to avoid such problems, we need to make a stable stand and mount the cameras and light sources on it. And that guarantees a steady shot. The second is cross-polarization. In order to capture the albedo image of an object, we need to get rid of specular reflections on its surface, because they will affect the accuracy of the image. By applying cross-polarization technique, we can get rid of unwanted specular reflections and thus get an albedo image of the object. Just like what you see here, it looks rather dark, dark and saturated. And that's exactly what the object should be like. So the more accurate the albedo image, the more true to life the object in the final image. We put a linear polarizing film over the light source to filter the undesired wavelengths. And we also use a polarizing filter on the camera lens to block some other waves with unwanted polarizations. These two polarizers help get rid of unwanted specular reflections. One tip for you is to make sure your polarizing films or filters are of good quality, because they are very important for reducing specular reflections. Third, we'll talk about the lighting. For better results, I suggest that you position light sources in at least 8 different directions. As photometric stereo requires parallel light rays, the lighting used need to be bright enough and evenly spreading with no fall-offs. Take this photo for example. When photographing these two leaves, we place a piece of white paper under them. We can see the intensity of the light varies in the corners. It's because the light we use fell off somehow, and this will cause a problem in the analyzing of source images. What problem will there be? Let's look at an example. I created this 3D scene with Blender and will use it to examine a lighting. We have taken source images with light coming from 16 directions. And in all these images, there are light fall-offs resulting in different degrees of brightness at corners. We will import these images to Details Capture. We get a normal map like this. One half predominantly blue and the other red. In fact, this is inaccurate. As we all know, RGB components correspond to the X, Y, and Z coordinates respectively of the surface normal. So such a normal map indicates a curved object instead of a horizontal one. However, as you see, the module we created is horizontal. Clearly, there is something wrong with the normals, and this problem is caused by the uneven lighting. Here are the source images generated with sunlight coming from 16 different directions. And this is the normal map we get, which signifies a horizontal object. The normals are okay now. In conclusion, obvious fall-offs of light will result in an incorrect normal map, just like this one, and this will lower the accuracy of the final image. So please make sure your light sources provide bright light and that there are no light follows in the photographing area. We'll add to details capture a feature that allows us to solve the problem of light follows. Then we come to the color temperature. It's best to use light sources with a color temperature of 6500K, which can help you get an accurate white balance and good color in the end. And we suggest photographing the object in a dark room. It's because ambient light and other types of light can affect the color of the final image. Photographing in a dark room allows us to avoid any interference of other lighting and enhance the accuracy of the photos. And now I'll say something about shadows. The higher the light source to the object, the shorter the shadow is, and the flatter the normal map will be, just like this one. When the light source is lower to the object, the shadow gets longer and the normal map will be more stereoscopic. As we can see, the second one has a higher saturation. So, when you're photographing something flat, like a piece of cloth or leather, you can lower down the light source to make the shadow longer, and then you produce a more stereoscopic normal map. Then I'll cover something about the softness of shadows. Compare these images. Those on the left have sharp shadows, but those on the right have pretty soft shadows. In the normal map generated from the left ones, we can see clear overlaps. For those images with soft shadows, there is no ghosting in their normal map. So, softening shadows helps us achieve a smooth normal map. Fourth, I'll talk about how to capture translucent images. Translucency is a pleasing visual effect, which can be used on plants to improve the feeling of vitality. Let's take a look at the leaves in the sunshine. Very beautiful, right? That is why we often want to photograph something translucent. Underneath a scanning setup, we have installed a 6500K light box. It emits strong light to illuminate translucent materials, such as cloth, leaves, and petals. Here are a few things to consider. Firstly, what kind of background should we use? A white one or a black one? We suggest using a black background. For example, these leaves are placed on a white background. We can see the reflections on the white paper as the light shines on it, and since the leaves curl up at the margin, the light will bounce up to the back of leaves, illuminate them from behind, and create some unwanted translucent areas, and that will lead to an incorrect albedo map, so we need a black background to block the bounce light. You'll need some special material, something that can block bounce light and allows light to go through. I'm using polarizing film here. Secondly, how to measure the light transmittance of various objects? Take leaves. There are various leaves. Some of them have a higher transmissivity than the others. You know, leaves can be dark gray, light gray, red, yellow, or sallow. And they can be thick or thin. How can we test the leaves' light transmittance? Let's look at the leaves here. The light yellow leaves allow better light transmission than the dark green ones. Thick leaves are of a lower transmissivity than the thin leaves. So, we need certain standards for photographing translucent things. Here is a quite simple way. We're using several sheets of white A4 paper. Just make sure the intensity of light on the first one is 60%. The light spot on the chrome ball will get much dimmer after we apply cross-polarization techniques, and this may cause a problem in light source identifying. There are two ways to solve this problem. Option 1. If you have your own scanning device with the lighting sources and cameras fixed in place, you can remove polarizing filters for a moment. Photograph the chrome ball. Use details capture to calculate the positions of the lighting sources and export a light file. Then use cross-polarization techniques and photograph the object without the chrome ball. We can read the light file here, and it will help produce the normal map. And we can always use this light file as long as there is no change made to the lighting sources and cameras. Option 2. As shown here, the light spot on the chrome ball is dim. We can make it brighter by drawing a white spot on it. And the same goes for all other source images. By doing this, we can help Details Capture recognize light sources. We'll soon add a function to Details Capture so that we can set the positions of lighting sources.